Testing. Testing, testing, there. Good morning. Welcome to Bethany Church. It's good to see each one of you here this morning. We have some special guests with us this morning. Warren Bitter's brother Glenn and Glenn's wife Marilyn. Thank you for joining us this morning. Appreciate it. We are blessed to have Pastor Reed Jolley sharing the Word of God with us this morning. Reed and his brother, Pastor Steve Jolley, took turns providing us with Sunday pulpit ministry for our Bethany Church for 2 years, in addition to them co-pastoring the Santa Barbara Community Church while we were undergoing a search for a senior pastor. And the way it worked was Reed would preach at Santa Barbara Community Church, and his brother, Steve, would come and preach at Bethany Church. And then the following week, they would switch. And they did this for 2 years while we were searching, and we eventually selected Anthony Chiboya to be our pastor. But we will always be grateful for their love, their graciousness, their sacrificial commitment, providing us with pastoral leadership during our time of need. And they'll always be cherished members of our Bethany family. So please give a warm welcome back to Pastor Reed Jolley. Our missions prayer this week is for the Global School of Sports Ministry and their executive director, Alyssa Carr Mahone. Their mission is to train prospective sports ministry leaders in the effective use of sports as a tool of evangelism and discipleship. We have several announcements. Face masks are optional for the immune compromised. Hearing aids are available for the hearing impaired or for those wanting translation from English to Japanese. The Santa Barbara Jail needs men's and women's jackets, sweaters, and sweatshirts. And men's tennis shoes, size 9 to 11, used is fine. Our annual Bethany Church picnic will be on Sunday, August 27th at Lower Manning Park. We encourage you to invite your family and friends. And Jan has a few announcements regarding the picnic.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm sure you've seen the flyer in here, and I am taking signups for a head count and also the food that you would like to bring. And we would like everybody to let us know the number in their group by August 20th, so Steve can do the shopping. And then I also have an announcement from Denise and Sagumi, because they're doing the raffle again. Neither one of them could be here today, so they just wanted me to let you know there's going to be a big box on the snack table, and there's a sheet that gives suggestions for raffle gifts. So if you would like to contribute to that, you can donate money or gift cards or whatever is on the sheet. And if you have money donations today, if you would give those to me, that would be great. And I'll get them to Denise. Thank you.
Yeah, please try to attend the picnic. We have delicious food. We have lots of games for children, and everybody enjoys the special raffle. We have probably 20 raffle prizes or so. So it's a lot of fun. Are there any praise reports or prayer requests this morning? Robert, why don't you?
Today is 14 full months today on my having returned back to our Lord and Savior. And I just want to make a quick announcement. Yesterday I was baptized. So.
Yes, yes. My prayer request is that we continue to lift up Tim in Japan. Please, he needs some prayer. Amen.
Oh, just a correction on Warren. It's Warren's sister, Catherine, and brother-in-law, Glenn, right? And the service is tomorrow at 2 o'clock, and it'll also be on Zoom and Facebook if you want to view it that way. And just an update on Diana Slagle also is hopefully moving to rehab this week, but she still has some kidney failure and is getting dialysis part of the time. So please keep Diana in your prayers.
Yeah. Any more praise reports or prayer requests? All right, let's spend time in prayer this morning. Father in heaven, thank you for your gift of eternal life through your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for your love, your grace and mercy, your healing power, your provision, your protection, your blessings, your comfort, your guidance, your hope, strength, and much more. Because of all these things, Lord, you alone are worthy of our praise and worship. We pray for your anointing on Pastor Reed as he ministers to us through your word. We pray for your continued guidance and blessing on the Global School of Sports Ministry. Thank you for the tithes and offerings brought to you. Please bless each gift and each giver. We continue to pray for your healing and strength for Bobby Kono, Alyssa Carr Mahone, Aaron Gray, John Slagle, Linda's niece Andrea, Tsugumi and her husband Rick, and her friends Mike, Rick, and Tammy, Lloyd Henning, Barbara Fukuzawa, Maurice, Gordon's sister Nora, Haru Sugino, Marge Smith, Veronica's friend Melissa, Utica, Derek, and their baby son. We pray your comfort for Warren Bitters and his family members for the recent loss of his mother, Arlene. We pray for Robert Esslinger to find steady employment, and thank you for the work that you have been providing him. We pray for Pastor Chuck as he does a worship service and Bible study at the county jail tonight. We pray for peace in Ukraine, Syria, Afghanistan, and other countries in conflict. We pray your guidance and wisdom on our city, county, state, and federal officials. We pray for revival in Santa Barbara. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's spend a moment to greet each other as the praise worship team comes forward.
All right, well, welcome again to the Bethany Worship Service. Today's message is going to be about the happiness of the Trinity, and we're also celebrating communion, and so we're going to start with celebration song, Happy Day. If you can stand up and join us,
And it's okay to clap and dance if you'd like. No, it's a celebration.
The greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive.
He's alive.
The empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive.
He's alive.
He's alive.
So excited I threw my pick. All right. King of Kings talks about what our Lord has done for us. Story of the gospel right here in this song.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope and without light, till the heavens you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from the throne of endless glory to the cradle in the feel the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation. You did not despise the cross, for even in your suffering you saw the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake you died.
Him forever. And now, preparation for celebrating communion. We'll sing Remember Me, one verse in English, and then a verse in Japanese, and then two more verses in English.
You eat it. trials us again. You are the
sacrificing your body, shedding your life blood for us, to give us life and forgiveness and redemption and eternal life. We praise you today. We worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. And we will celebrate communion now, which is open to all who have confessed Jesus as Lord and Savior. You don't need to be a member of Bethany Church in order to take part in communion with us. So, I suru kyodai tachi, skuinushi yes Christo, shinjite iru mono wa, seisan ni marakarete imasu. Izure no kyokai no katagata mo, seisan o, o uketori kudasai. And I'll ask the servers to come, and as they pass out the elements, we'll read scriptures together. And let's see. Today we're going back to pre-COVID style. So we have bread and juice in separate dishes.
In Matthew 26, starting with verse 26, we read, "Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, he gave it to the disciples, and he said, 'Take and eat, this is my body.' And at the end of the meal, he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom.'" Let's pray. Lord, we thank you again for what you did for us. Lord, I just ask that you prepare our hearts and help us to forgive anyone that we have neglected to forgive. We'd make things right with you and with our brothers and sisters today. Lord, we pray that you would just renew us again and bring us into a stronger relationship with yourself. We thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice on our behalf. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the Lord Jesus said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Shu Yesu wa ko iwarimashita. Tote tabi nasai. Kore wa anata gata no tame ni etairu watashi no karada desu. Watashi wo oboiru tame ni kono yo ni shinasai. So please take the bread. And at the end of the meal, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Yesu wa ko iwarimashita. Kono sakazuki wa watashi no chi niyoru atanashi keyaku desu. Kore o nomu tabi ni watashi o oboe nasai. Please. Thank you, Lord. Again, we remember what you did. May we never forget the sacrifice you made on our behalf, that you loved us so much that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And we praise you and thank you and ask your continued blessing on the rest of our service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Reed Jolley now.
It's great to be here. We have kind of a fun, long relationship together, and I'm grateful for the chance to be here. Before we look to God's Word, I just want to give you a little bit of word about what Lisa and I are doing. I quit my job at Santa Barbara Community Church 5 years ago, just about now, the 1st of August. And the first year was a little murky, and then we had this thing called COVID. I don't know if you heard about it. But right before COVID, we signed up for an organization called Global Training Network. And what Global Training Network does is they send their ideal person is someone who's been a pastor for 25 years or more. And we go overseas to the majority world where there are pastors who have no training. And we do week-long cohorts of training. And kind of the ideal was you'd have a group of pastors and you'd go back four times a year for 3 years and you'd give them sort of the basics. So we have been to Albania twice. We're going again in September. We've been to Tanzania once. We're going again in January. We've been to Tanzania. We've been to Zambia. We've been to Brazil. We've been around a lot. And we have a lot of plans for 24. We're going to be going to Cambodia, Lord willing. We'll be going to Ethiopia. And one more trip in there to Tanzania. So if you ever wonder, and you're in the middle of the night, where would Reed be? You just picture me on the back of an airplane with, you know, right next to the restroom. It's a great place to sit. And so we're thrilled. It's hard work, and it's good work. It's received with real enthusiasm. I've talked with Westmont professors, and they tell me they're jealous of me because for example, the last time we were in Tanzania, the last day they realized we were leaving, and they said, well, could you meet a couple of hours early in the morning so we have more time for teaching? I said, yeah, we can do that. And I still haven't caught up with my sleep, but we're super, super thankful that God's allowing us to be part of this. And I appreciate your prayers. If by chance you'd like to receive our updates, these are not appeals for money, but from the field, we send little updates with pictures. We try to keep them super short because we want people to pray for us. So mainly it's pictures. But if you'd like to receive those, give me your email address when we're done. Make sure I can read it, and you'll be getting them from Albania soon. And if you don't want them, I won't be offended. But and if you do get them and you don't want to read them, I'll never know. But so just think of all the power you have there. Well, I want us to think a little bit about God. Think about the way, well, the way the Gospel of Matthew begins, pretty much Mark and Luke, the same thing. Jesus is born. That's important. he's worshipped by the Magi in the East. He makes a flight to Egypt to save his life. He returns to Nazareth, and we pretty much don't hear anything about him for the better part of 30 years. And then a man who may be the cousin of Jesus shows up in southeastern Israel by the Jordan, and he is a prophet, and he's baptizing. And the people recognize that he has the Spirit of God on him, and this is the first time since maybe the time of Ezra where God's Spirit seems to be working, and there's a prophetic utterance that is worth listening to. You remember when they rebuilt the temple, and there's no fire, and there's no smoke, and the older people wept because it was just, there was no glory. But here comes John the Baptist, and people are coming, even the religious people are coming. The Pharisees and the Sadducees are coming, and he's not real welcoming. He says, hey, who warned you, brood of vipers, to flee from the coming wrath? I mean, that's not a way to get people into your church. But evidently, they are getting baptized, and along comes, one day, Jesus of Nazareth. And here's what the text tells us. I want you just to hear it, and then when I'm done, I'll tell you exactly where it is so you can look at it, okay? So let's just listen to God's word. Then Jesus came from Galilee, up north, down to the Jordan to John to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, I need to be baptized by you, and you come to me. But he persuaded him, let it be so for now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he consented, and when Jesus was baptized, immediately coming up out of the water, the heavens were open to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him. And behold, a voice from heaven said, this is my son, my beloved son, with whom I am well pleased. Thus ends the reading of God's word. Say amen. Yeah, amen. Wow, what a passage. There are a lot of things we could say about these verses that we're not going to say. But I want us to ask one simple question. What does the passage teach us about the God whom we worship? A.W. Tozer, years and years ago, said, what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. The greatest question before the church, before Bethany Congregational Church, is always God himself. And the most significant fact about any man is not what he at any given time may say or do, but what he deep in his heart conceives God to be like. Have you ever thought about that? We tend, I love this, he says, we tend by a secret law of the soul to move toward our mental image of God. So let's give that a little bit of thought. What is your mental image of God? Who is he? What do you think about? How do you understand God at this place in your Christian faith? Maybe in this room there are some who are not yet followers of Christ, and I would just ask you, think about your friends who know Christ and ask yourself the question, how do they view God? Is God, is he harsh? Is he unloving? Is he vindictive? Is he really concerned that somebody's having too much fun? Is that, he broke number 4 of the Ten Commandments. We better take care of that. Is that God? Or is God capricious? One day he's happy, one day he's sad. He's in a bad mood in the afternoon, he's in a good mood in the evening. Is that the God that we worship? Maybe you like books about God. I do. I found an ad for one the other day. I thought I'd do a little show and tell for you. This is from World Magazine. I'm not criticizing this book. It's just the kind of book I would buy. I didn't buy this one because I had enough going. But no criticism. It's by Terry L. Johnson. And the title is The Excellencies of God. It's probably a good book. And around the perimeter of the title of the book are the excellencies of God. I'll read them to you. Patience, truth, faithfulness, blessedness, fatherhood, spirituality, wisdom, mercy. Those are 11 attributes of God that must be 11 chapters in this book. Fair enough. Did anybody notice something that might be missing? Happiness. The happiness of God is not mentioned at all. Main point this morning, you can go home, you can make me happy because you're going to know the main point of the sermon. It is this, that God is fundamentally happy. Can anybody say amen to that? Amen. Don't you want to worship a God who's happy? I mean, I went around the world on a ship years and years ago, 1980, and there was this gal on the ship who was so happy. And I would watch her from a distance, and everywhere she went, there would be 3 people with her. They would be laughing and playing and talking, and she's beautiful. And I said, I want her to be my wife, because she was happy. And I thought, if she can be happy without me, just think how happy she could be with me. So we just celebrated our 42nd anniversary. I wish we'd gotten married in Brazil on the trip, and we'd be celebrating our 43rd anniversary, but she would have none of it. I don't know why. Get this. God needs nothing. You ever think of that? He's never in a bad mood. He's completely self-sufficient. He is utterly happy. Everything good in the universe flows from the happiness of God. So main point again, God is fundamentally happy, and watch this. This is going to bug us a little bit, some of us anyway. Because this is so, we have a responsibility to be happy as well. And I'm going to explain that this week and next. But because God is so happy, we want to be near him. Now, some of you, if you're wise, and you are, I know, you're saying, well, Reed, where is that in the Bible? By the way, I'm looking at Matthew chapter 3, if you want to turn in your Bibles there. But we're saying, well, where does the Bible specifically say that God is happy? Well, let me ask a question here, a little intimate. How many of us in the room have children? Most. And do you remember when you got pregnant the first time? You said, how did that happen? That's what I said to my, I said, what? And before we got pregnant, I never saw children in Santa Barbara. They weren't here. I wondered about it, and within about an hour, I started seeing children everywhere. Do you remember that experience? You go to Vons, and there's kids, and you go you know, down State Street, where do all these kids come from? And you go to the park and there's children. And in other words, you have eyes to see. Well, listen, when we see the happiness of God in the Bible anywhere, we will begin to see the happiness of God everywhere. The passage before us in Matthew chapter 3, verses 13 to 17, testifies ultimately to the happiness of God. It testifies to what God is like. God is, big words here, I know it's August and you'll get through it, promise September will come, but the big word here is the word Trinity. The God we worship is one and triune at the same time. So important that we understand that. All three persons of the triune God are in these in this little passage, and they are delighting in one another. Look at your text. The Son, who comes from Galilee down to the Jordan to be baptized, he's a happy God because he's God in the flesh. He's coming to be baptized to inaugurate his ministry of redemption. This is the beginning. We really don't know what he's been doing the last 30 years, but now we do. The Spirit sees the baptism that John the Baptist performs, and what happens? The heavens open, and the Spirit descends and rests on Jesus. This is the anointing. The happy Holy Spirit is falling on the happy Son, and not to be outdone, the Father, he can't keep his mouth shut. The Father says, "This is my Son, my beloved Son. He's the one in whom I am well pleased." He wants everyone there to know it. His happiness issues forth in this verbal proclamation. So the Father is so happy in and with his Son that he can't shut up about it. Matthew chapter 17, same book, just a few chapters later, Jesus takes Peter, James, and John, his favorites. He takes them up on the Mount of Transfiguration. You remember that? And they go up there, and then Moses and Elijah join them. It must have been quite a deal. And, of course, Peter, it's always Peter, he says, "Hey, how about if I build a couple of tents and we'll stay here forever?" and no, that's not a good idea. But as they're up there, you've got the glorified Son. You've got the work of the Spirit in doing the glory, and the Father speaks again and says, "This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased." The Father cannot shut up about it. Or think about John chapter 12. In John chapter 12, remember Jesus came to save the sins of the world? In John chapter 12, finally the world comes to Jesus. We read in John 12 that the Greeks were coming to him. That's the world. In the Jewish mind, you were either a Jew or you were a Greek. So everybody in this room, unless we are Jewish, we are Greeks, all of us, from a Jewish perspective. And they say, "Sir, may we see Jesus?" And they get to see Jesus. And when the world comes to them, Jesus realizes his mission is almost complete. And he says, he ponders what he ought to pray. Do you remember John 12? He says, "Father, what shall I say? Spare me from this hour? No, it was for this hour that I came." So he hasn't prayed that. That's what he might have wanted to pray. He says, I need to pray another prayer. "Father, glorify your name." Remember that? And do you remember what happened? Out of the heavens comes another voice. And the Father says, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." So the Father cannot shut up about the Son. And the Son is always pointing to the glory of the Father. Now you say, what does this have to do with the happiness of the God that we worship? We worship a happy God. All that God does is happiness. All that God does flows from his happiness. And God's will is always good news. At the heart of that happiness is the triunity of God. Three persons, not three members. Three persons in one God. Or to put it more accurately, one God who is three persons. Michael Reeves wrote a really great little book called Delighting in the Trinity. If you want a book on this, this is the book to read, Delighting in the Trinity. It's short, and it has pictures, and it's funny. I mean, how much better does it get than that? Delighting in the Trinity. He says this, the Trinity is the governing center of all Christian belief. The truth that shapes all and beautifies all others. The Trinity is the cockpit of all Christian thinking. So thinking about God in the abstract does not warm our hearts. John Calvin put it like this back in the 16th century. If we try to think about God without thinking about the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, then only the bare and empty name of God flutters in our brains to the exclusion of the true God. Okay, are you ready? Are you awake? You need to stand up and stretch, or are you okay? Okay, if you need to stand up and stretch, I won't be offended. What do we mean when we say Trinity? Ready? We don't mean that there's one God up here who sometimes shows up as the Son, and then the same God sometimes shows up as the Spirit. We don't mean that. And that one God up here sometimes shows up as the Father. You see the Father, the Spirit, and the Son? You see them right there? That's called modalism, that there's some God behind God who is sometimes Father, sometimes Spirit, sometimes Son. That's a Christian heresy. Nor do we mean that God is like this. Well, there's the Father, and there's the Son, and there's the Spirit. And there's nothing back here. That's called tritheism, that we worship three gods. Inadvertently, pastors will sometimes play into this. Some pastors, I have no idea how you pray, so if I offend you, I'm not trying to. Some pastors pray, Father God, 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 Father God. And so over the course of the year, you have heard Father God referred to about 5,000 times, okay? Other pastors pray, Lord Jesus, 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 to the exclusion of the Father and the Spirit. And then, of course, you've got, you know, the more charismatic among us, and it's Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. It's a question of emphasis. But my friends, we worship a triune God. What difference does that make? Why do we care? We worship a triune God. I'm going to give you another definition from Wayne Grudem. God is three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Each person is fully God, and there is one God. You want it again? It's pretty easy. God is three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Each person is fully God, and there is one God. We worship a triune God, not three separate gods, not one God who shows up in three different ways. Now, most evangelicals, in my experience, we are fuzzy Trinitarians. We just don't quite get it. And we're always longing for an analogy that will work. They don't work. God is like a four-leaf clover. You've heard that one. God is, or three-leaf clover, I guess I should say. God is like ice and water and steam. No, every single natural illustration that you'll come up with, I guarantee, will err on the side of modalism, on the one side, or of monism on the other side, of one God who shows up in different ways. No, the Trinity stands on its own. The point I want us to see is this, simple. Okay, the hard part's over, all right? I want us to see this, that God is one and yet three, and that is the heart of his happiness. His triune nature is the heart of his happiness. Why? Because at the center of who God is the love between the persons of the Trinity. The doctrine of the Trinity explains why God can be supremely happy, concerned only for his own glory, and yet not be a selfish God. We worship a God of all glory, and this God properly exalts the worship of himself, and the persons of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, they are other-centered. The Father is centered on the Son and the Spirit. The Son is centered on the Father and the Spirit. The Spirit is centered on the Father and the Son. And there's a love relationship. A.H. Strong, a Baptist theologian from Upper State New York, said, love is an impossible exercise to a solitary being. That's why Allah in Islam, Allah cannot be a God of love. There is no one for Allah to love. Anybody remember a movie? If you remember this, I'm impressed. It was called A 2001 Space Odyssey. Yeah. Was that boring or what? No. You liked it? Come on, really? Well, it came out when I was in junior high, and we said that, but no, we didn't understand it. But just to spoil it, spoiler alert, you're not going to watch it anyway, but it's a real long movie, and there's this big oblong rock, and the movie takes place in four parts. It came out in 1968, and it goes from the dawn of time to the future, which was 2001. Think about that for a minute. And the rock just sits there. It doesn't move. It doesn't talk. It doesn't do anything. And, you know, most reviewers, if you disagree, we'll talk about it afterwards. So they saw Stanley Kubrick, who made the movie, that was God. God is just there. My friends, that is not the God of the Bible. We worship a God with personality. A God who's disappointed in our sin, a God who delights when his children thrive, a God who made all kinds of plants and animals and doggies and kitties. No, he didn't make kitties, but, you know, cat jokes always work. But we worship a God who is creative, who is loving. He's not like the gods of the ancient Near East, Dagon, Molech, Baal. Those gods demanded child sacrifice, not our God. Our God is not like one of the 330 million gods of Hinduism. Our God is not like the Greco-Roman gods who were fickle, capricious, violent, sexually immoral. The triune God, we got to know this, is not like that. The triune God of the Bible is saturated with his own glory, his own personality, his own beauty, his relationship, his love, and his happiness, such that, get this, we will never grow tired of this God. When we've been with him face to face for, let's say, 10,000 or 100,000 years, we will still be learning. The God of the Bible is not like the stone of 2001 Space Odyssey. We worship the lively, full of joy, tri-personal God, one God who is three persons. And this God, get this, this God is the happiest being in the universe. You ever think about that? That you worship the happiest being in the universe? Before the church, this will blow your mind, before the church, before the first Christmas, before King David, before Abraham left Ur of the Chaldees, before Adam and Eve, there was God already eternally loving, happy in fellowship, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Or to put it a little bit differently, before you ever had a happy moment in your life, before that happened, before your great-grandparents ever had a happy moment in their lives, before Adam and Eve ever frolicked in the garden, God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit were happy. Now, sometimes children have the boldness to ask questions that we would like to ask, like, what was God doing before he created the universe? You know Martin Luther's answer to that? Somebody asked Martin Luther, the great reformer, what was God doing before he created the universe? And he said, oh, he was making big whips for people who ask questions like that. What was God doing before he created the universe? He was delighting in being himself, the fellowship of the triune God. Jesus prays on the night of his betrayal, and now, Father, glorify me with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. Other children, I was one of these children, they asked their dad, why did God create the universe? Now, my dad was not a theologian, a great guy, died 3 years ago, and he gave me the wrong answer. Dad, why did God create the universe? You know what he said? He said, well, he was lonely, so he needed some company. So he created Adam and Eve, and voila, he got some friends. No. God was not incomplete in any way. He was not lonely in any way. He's a God of love, and out of his love comes his children. He couldn't contain himself. So what can we say about this God? We're just about done. Number one, you know it already. This God is infinitely and always happy. Now, some of you are maybe a little bothered right now. You're thinking, oh, why not the word joy, Reed? Happy seems so surfacey. Okay, go ahead with the word joy if you like. You know, our English translations have done that. There's a Greek word, makarios, which in Greek literature, you translate that, you usually use the word happiness. And translations of yesteryear would translate that word happiness. But somehow, we've gotten a little too religious for that, and the vast majority of our translations in English, well, they want to use the word blessed. I'll give you one example. You ready? 1 Timothy 1:11. This is from the English Standard Version, which I use. Paul speaks of the gospel of the glory of the blessed God. Makarios, blessed. But the word makarios means happy. Randy Elkhorn wrote a book called Happiness. Great book if you want to read a big, fat, 400-page book on happiness. Excellent. But he compared on this verse 45 English translations looking at how the word makarios was translated. 42 of them used the religious-sounding word blessed. But then he went in those 42 chapters, translations, and he went and looked at how they translated the word elsewhere in the New Testament. And over again, they translated the word happy. Somehow, we recoil at the thought that, hey, we worship a happy God, but we do. He must have a sense of humor, right? Who else would create people that look like us? God is happy. I was teaching on the Trinity in Zambia, Africa, and one of the Africans said, I've never heard this. And if you've never heard this, what a shame. What a shame to go through the Christian life and not realize we worship a God who is fundamentally happy. This makes all the difference in the world in our approach to God. I have a granddaughter, she's 6 years old. I have 8 grandchildren. Can you imagine that? So everybody wants something all the time. But they're fun. My granddaughter Elsie, she a few months ago, We'd been gone for a month, and her parents and their three, four kids came over to our house, and I said, Elsie, so good to see you. I've missed you so much. Did you miss me? And as only a six-year-old can do, she said, no. And she just looks at me and says, I didn't even think about you. You know, it hit me. I thought, that's my relationship with God sometimes. I don't think about him. I don't even miss him. Why? Because I'm not hanging with him. How do I do that? I open his word. The Bible is a book about Christ. Jesus said so. Read Luke 24. He explains to the disciples on the road to Emmaus. He explains the whole from Matthew and the Psalm, from Moses and the Psalms, that everything that was written about him. You want to know how fun and how loving and how happy God is? Read the Bible, and you'll find it on every page. So God is happy. Number two, because God is happy, we want to be with this God. I married my wife largely because she was a happy person, and I thought, I want to be with her. If she can be happy without me, I want her to be happy with me. Thirdly, since we worship a God who is infinitely happy, and since we are made in God's image, as Paul tells us we are made to be imitators of God. What does that mean? Help me. We're to be happy. We're called to be happy. We have a responsibility to be happy. Now, again, somebody's thinking, oh, Chuck, you brought a prosperity preacher here. No. With all of life's difficulties and sufferings, and there will be many, I've been through many in the last 5 years. I've been through some of the hardest years of my life. I have found, you can be very miserable and very happy at the same time. And our happiness is rooted in the future, that God's going to give us a new body. He's going to take care of us. And all those things that are sad are going to become untrue. So I can be happy right now. Jeremy Taylor, sometimes it's called the Shakespeare of the Puritans. His dates are 1613 to 1677. He knew a little bit about suffering. He and his wife lost two kids. They buried two children. Then his wife died. Then Jeremy Taylor went to prison because of his preaching the gospel as a nonconformist in England. He suffered. He knew about suffering. Listen to this from this same guy. God threatens terrible things if we will not be happy. God's going to get you if you're not happy. And you know, it's all over the scriptures, isn't it? Rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again, rejoice. You go through the Psalms and there's a gazillion commands to rejoice in God, to be joyful, even in the midst of suffering. I love when I just found Deuteronomy chapter 24, Moses promises Israel that in the future, the nation will endure chastisement and God's wrath. Why? Listen, all these curses shall come upon you because you did not, listen to this, because you did not serve the Lord with joyfulness and with gladness of heart because of the abundance of all things. Somehow, Israel is going to serve God, but without joy, without happiness. And God says, that's not enough. So I'm going to leave you with that thought. You got an assignment. Every sermon has to have an assignment. This is a good one, right? You go home today and be happy. Not because everything's perfect in your life. Not because your body's perfect. Mine's sure not. You go home and be happy because you worship a triune God who is happy. Amen. We say amen in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. God, if there are any in this room who have yet to bow their knee to you, we pray that they would do so and join this fellowship of the Trinity. For the rest of us, Lord, forgive us for focusing too much on ourselves and not enough on you. And we pray that the infectious joy of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit would be ours. And we pray that for your glory, in your name, and God's people said, amen. What do we do?
Thank you. We have one more song.
All right. A happy song, I hope.
Well, I think it's a happy song. It's it's a well-known song. Holy, holy, holy. You know, our gospel choir in Japan sang a version of this that I loved. And we sang it one time in a prison in Japan. And this prison guard came up to me, a lady, afterwards. She said, I have never heard a song like that. Please, could you give me a recording of that? That was the most amazing song. And I just hope that she came to know our God as her Savior. But just focus on the holiness and happiness of our Lord as we sing Holy, Holy, Holy. Us happy. You fill us with joy. And Lord, I just thank you that you took the time to create the universe, create us, that we could have fellowship with you and enjoy your happiness for eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And our doxology now, the traditional doxology today.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
And now from the book of Jude. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. So please go in peace and please join us for fellowship in the courtyard and give your email to Pastor Reed if you'd like to get their newsletter.